in Brazil. I'm sorry, in Portugal. I didn't say Mozambique. And he also teaches law. He is, I mean, he has been, I mean, he's a very sort of, he's been flying all over. But I think the more important part is that what I found is that he's not just one of those academics who are there. He has been involved in several activities. In fact, one of the founder members of the World Social Forum. And I think, so it is, and he's been very much obsessed. Now they're doing a big major project called ALICE, Breaking Mirrors, which is, you know, basically trying to see what the South can contribute to the North. This is normally the other way around. The colonizing countries think that they can dictate to others. Whereas he's trying to do the reverse version of that. It's a major project he's worked on the European Research Council, I think, and the name is right. But I think we don't want to do it like the word is.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's thank you, Sherry. When you can use my country and my fellow country, usually sometimes people think that I'm from Brazil, but I work so much in Brazil that I'm not from Portugal. It's a great pleasure to be here, and the topic that Ivan chose, because there were several topics that I could talk about, is a topic that probably sounds very strange to all of you. Did you hear that with all these facts?
Not what it is. Is it this week?
It's working now. Well, I think I can start with a very simple idea in my view. I think that we are confronting in the years to come, everywhere in the world, but in different ways, Global South, Global North, we are going to confront seven major mega trends. And these trends are going to have an impact on the social sciences in general. And these mega trends are, first, the concentration of wealth, which goes up and up everywhere. Ecological disaster, which is very likely that we destroy the planet before we lift our people from poverty. The hollowing out of democracy, that is to say, the deconsolidation of democracy. Devaluation of labor, everywhere. Marketization of knowledge, knowledge as a commodity. Universities, in fact, becoming also corporations in many countries. Criminalization of social protest, everywhere. And finally, the end of the economic hegemony of the global north, that is to say, of Europe and North America. And the least talked about megatrend, in my view, is the last one, the end of the hegemony, or hegemony, of global north on the economic level. Every 4 years, the National Intelligence Council, which is the CIA instrument, but we should pay attention to what they write, every 4 years, they write a report to the incoming president of the United States. And 2012 report called Megatrends 2030. They say that this moment will be the moment in which global North, that is to say Europe and North America, will lose the hegemony in the world economy. Today, together with Japan, this area accounts for 56% of the global economy. In 2030, they will account for 25% of the global economy. So the global economy will move south. And they gave it a very interesting phrase. By 2030, Asia will be on its way to return to being the world's powerhouse, just as it was before 1500, as you said, before the European expansion. In a sense, back to Asia. I'm not very much concerned about the truthfulness of this prediction. Times are very valuable. But what I'm interested in is that there are some movements that show that something is changing. So-called emerging economies, which have been called the BRICS, of which India is one of them. And these emerging economies, even though they have already a lot of clout in the global economy, they don't have any comparable power in the financial multinational institutions. These institutions, particularly global financial capital, is still dominated by Europe and North America, particularly North American banks. So there is a trend here that you can see that these countries, so-called emerging economies, which is really a very unfortunate concept, because we are talking about countries where a millennial civilization and culture only are emerging now. But these countries and their possibilities are always precarious. These emerging economies are always about to collapse, precisely because they don't control the instruments of global financial capital. It is curious that since last year, we don't talk anymore about BRICS. It was Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa. We are now talking about the Fragile Five. And the Fragile Five are Brazil, India, South Africa, Indonesia, and Turkey. That is to say, of the previous BRICS, at least three are fragile, as they said. These are categories from the consultancy agencies of Goldman Sachs. As they invented BRICS, they have invented the Fragile Five. It doesn't escape to anyone the fact that all these Fragile Five are functioning democracies. The only ones that are not fragile is one country whose democratic nature is problematic, Russia, and one that is not even problematic, China. So these countries, non-democratic countries, seem to be strong. All the others are agile. It shows probably that capitalism and democracy are more and more incompatible. The political risks of democracy seem to be something that they are very concerned about. And if you look at what they are thinking this year, they are very concerned about the elections in Brazil, then the elections in India, big countries. They are very, very much concerned about the elections. And you know, it's not difficult to predict who are the favorite winners for so-called business community, which, as you know, is a euphemism for global capital, basically. They have already chosen the favorite winners of the current election, both in Brazil and in India. So, I think that if global capitalism is moving global south, what does it mean? A change in content of global capital? A change in protagonism of different protagonists, different protagonists but the same type of domination? What is going to be changed? The global south is a very, very ambiguous concept, because if you look at what's happening throughout the global south, you can see that the global south very often repeats, reproduces the global north in terms of exploitation, domination, suppression. If you ask Mozambicans what is the difference between an Indian mining company or a Brazilian mining company or a Canadian mining company, they don't have a difference. They don't know the difference. All of them are ruthless in destroying the mine. All of them are ruthless in taking away the land of peasants, displacing peasants. So the idea of the global south is ambiguous. At the same time, the global south is also a huge and diverse landscape of social movements, of social organizations that fight against global capitalism. I was, from the beginning, very involved in the World Social Forum. And in fact, my first visit here to India was to Mumbai, here in Mumbai actually, in 2004, for the World Social Forum. And here we met that social movements coming from all over the world. And I think it was the first and most important show of Dalit movements here in this country. 30,000 Dalit participants in the World Social Forum. So there is this global south of oppression, domination, and resistance against oppression, domination, exploitation, land, displacement, and so on. And this probably is something that we have to take into account in our analysis as social scientists. So if these things are changing, the question is this going to have an impact on our social sciences, on the way we think in sociology, political science, anthropology? One could say probably nothing, you know, just analyze this movement. I don't think so. I think that it makes a difference, and we should probably analyze the difference. And probably the difference is the topic of my presentation. And let's take two examples. I think that we could probably take two examples to show what I mean by what I'm saying. The knowledge that we have been using in the social sciences is a knowledge, the scientific knowledge that we master, is a scientific knowledge that is adequate enough to account for the struggles, for the movements that are resisting against global capitalist domination in the world. Or do we need other kinds of knowledges, other kinds of sciences? So this topic may be very strange to you, because I think we are very well established social scientists, we are a very well established institute of social sciences, and probably what I'm saying is almost is famous. But in any case, that's my own restlessness about knowledge today, is that I think that in the social sciences we don't account for the diversity of these experiences going on around the world, particularly because the sciences that we master and use and teach and learn, social sciences that are very Eurocentric. They came from Western modernity, Eurocentric. They were developed, created as social theories in the mid-19th century and early 20th century in five countries of Europe and later on in the United States. So my problem is always this. At that point, most of the people in the world were colonists. They were not known. They were not considered. They were not taken into account. But today is different. And if the global capitalism is changing, it shows that the global south is becoming more and more visible. Could these theories account for the realities of the global south? The founders of the global of the science, as far as of sociology, Max Weber, Marx, Durkheim, they have in mind the realities of Europe at the time. But the realities in Brazil, the realities in Asia, the realities in Africa are very different. Can they account anything for them? So that's the question I would like to discuss with you, based on some examples. For instance, I think that the knowledge that we have, the knowledge is very important for us to consider the world as our own. Because if you consider the world as our own, we can change it. And my question is that the theories that we have developed probably do not allow most people in the world to conceive of the world as their own. They are more objects of history than subjects of history. And I give you this example. If I teach you or learn sociology in Europe, and I teach the founders of the sociology, Durkheim, Max Weber, and Marx, I'm talking about authors that are very important for the area in which I am, Europe, or North America. These were the realities they had in mind where they developed the histories. But suppose that I'm teaching sociology in Morocco or Indonesia, and I'm teaching young students that the founders of sociology are these three guys, no woman, actually. What should the students do? Well, these are European guys that have been analyzing European realities. They may be globally relevant, but are just these guys the only guys that count for the social sciences? So, if I were teaching these authors in Morocco or in Tunisia, probably the students would not perceive these authors as relating to their realities. But suppose that I add to those three people, scholars, a fourth one, Ibn Khaldun. Ibn Khaldun is a great historian, economist, geography, sociologist, political scientist, that was born in Tunis in 1333. And he wrote a marvelous Mukaddimah, the prologue to a universal history. Never in Europe or in North America, this scholar was considered a founder of social sciences. But for me, he's one of the founders. And if you read Ibn Khaldun, you can see that he pays attention to phenomena that escaped Marx, that escaped Durkheim, and that escaped Weber. Because the realities of that North African area at the time were different. We had to address other issues. And therefore, for the students there, whatever they learn from him and Khaldun is probably even more important. And not just for them, for all of us. Because many of the problems that Ibn Khaldun addresses are problems that we can find throughout Africa and throughout Asia. What is the role of religion in society? For Marx, Durkheim and Weber, there was not much of a problem because European societies were secular. Separation between state and religion. But this is very exceptional. And today, in many countries, you have lots of problems about this. If this country can ban some books, as they have done recently, with Willy Donegan's book, what are the limits of secularism? So situations are complex, and these authors address the issue. So that's my first example. The second example is the concept of development. As you know, this concept was developed at the end of the Second European War to express the idea that only a few countries were developed. Probably five, six countries were developed, and the rest of the world was underdeveloped. And this idea of development was based on two premises. The first one is that the developed and the underdeveloped are two very separate entities. They are not connected. That is to say, the development of the developed countries has nothing to do with the underdevelopment of the underdeveloped countries. And the second idea is that it is the moral obligation of the developed countries to help the underdeveloped, but to help them to develop in very much the same way as the developed. So there is no other alternative future. It's the same future of the developed countries. So if you look back to this, you get a little bit intrigued. Because after all, social scientists in global north developed a concept that puts more than 3/4 of the world population in the wrong side of history. They are underdeveloped, all of them. Only a few are developed. And the underdeveloped is very interesting, are not just underdeveloped as economies, they are underdeveloped as cultures, as institutions, as legal systems, as habits. So, sometimes I pause and think, suppose that this vast majority of countries in the world, so-called underdeveloped world, were about to make sense of the world and to create a category to classify the world. Would they come up with this type of conception? That would put them in a very bad light because they are underdeveloped, so they are diminished by the concept. Normally, if these countries were to invent concepts, they probably would not invent concepts that would put them in a very diminishing light, in a very diminishing reality, as if they owed everything to the developed, to the few developed countries. So, I think that probably if we take these two examples, we can see that most of our social theories, in their origins, they had a very interesting dichotomy, which probably is not well noticed by our professors and our researchers everywhere, is that the North, the global North, is always the solution. The global South is always the problem. The global South was the realm of savagery, of barbarism, of dangerous diseases, of barbarian dictators. So they were problematic from the very beginning. And the global North provides the solution. So, are our social sciences immune to this dichotomization? Would it be possible not to reverse, that is to say, now the North is the problem and the South is the solution? Probably not. But probably to understand that the problems of some are solutions of others. Problem that is underdeveloped because there is development. There is poverty because there is concentrated wealth in some. So, problems of some are solutions for others. And this happens in the North and in the South. Would it be possible to have a different type of learning experience around the world that would not put part of the population of the world in the wrong side of history? I think it is possible today, and my work is basically that. Because my idea is the following, that working with the movements in Latin America and now in Africa, in Mozambique, Angola, and South Africa, and starting a project with some of my friends, like Charles Bonnick, involved in his team, involved in my new project, we are trying to have a different conversation of the world, a more horizontal conversation. But for that, I think that we have to change our lenses, change our concepts, or probably change the meaning of our concepts. And that's what I consider to be epistemologies of the sun, is this endeavor. Epistemology, as you know, is the area in which, or the realm of studies, where we study the processes by which knowledge is created and validated. Well, knowledge in hegemonic social sciences have been developed in the North and validated in the North. And in fact, even today, and I have this struggle for many years, whenever I speak in Europe or in the United States, where I teach part of my time, about the good quality, the excellent quality of the social science produced in India, or in South Africa, or in Brazil, I have two responses. Very often. One is, whatever they are doing, we already did. And second, if we didn't do what they are doing, it's because it is irrelevant. So you never manage to bring even social scientists to the conversation, because we don't consider them as equal. So that's why this project in which we are involved is not a project of specialists coming from there or there, from any European or North American country, studying India. We are bringing together scholars from India, from South Africa, from Mozambique, from Brazil, from Bolivia, from Ecuador, different countries in which different realities are addressed, in which some creativity in production of theories may be developed. And this is what we have been calling epistemology of the South, a first approximation. So we have two big challenges in the social sciences when viewed from this perspective of looking with other lenses from the experiences of the South. And the South here is not geographical. Australia for me is North. Haiti, even though it is in the Northern Hemisphere, is South. South is not geographically, geopolitical. The global South is the sets of countries and ideas and experiences of people that have experienced the injustices, the oppressions, the exploitation of global capitalism, colonialism, and patriarchy. So there is a South within the North. You know that the life expectancy of the black kids in Washington, D.C. in the United States is not much higher than the one in Bangladesh. So there is a South inside the North. And in Europe, we have also a South. All the immigrants, victims of racism, xenophobia, deportation, slave-like labor. We have that. And they are not recognized as such as citizens, even if they have a passport. Even they are citizens, formally, they are discriminated against by police. So there is a South within the North. And this is to capture the experience of people that suffer these humiliations, exploitations, oppressions. It's a duty for these critical social theories that we are trying to develop. And there are two challenges. The first challenge is what we call the internal pluralism of scientific knowledge. That is to say, even if you take sociology, a political science, or anthropology, there are many different ways of doing this science. Not just one is one. And we should account for this diversity, because these concepts, be it democracy, be it human rights, be it whatever, when transposed to other cultures, they get other meanings, other ideas that are put inside them, and probably there are other concepts other than these that should be considered. So the problem here is the following. If I take too seriously, for instance, the Indian cultural difference, we are in India, the Indian cultural difference, am I not running the risk of cultural insensitivity? And say, well, India is different culture, and therefore the social sciences, Eurocentric, Western-centric social science don't apply to us. But if I fall into this kind of essentialism, I'm forgetting two things. First, is that there is no such thing as Indian culture. There are internal diversities inside India, as there are internal diversities in South Africa. Can I say that the culture of the black people in South Africa is the same as the white people in South Africa? Obviously not. Or the Afro-descendants in Brazil, or the indigenous people in Brazil, and the white people in Brazil, there are differences. So there are internal differences. That's the first point. The second is even worse, is that if I can see the cultural difference into kind of a essential states, culture are incommensurate. I mean, an Indian culture is incommensurate with Islamic culture, is incommensurate with indigenous cultures, is incommensurable with Judeo-Christian cultures. So if you get these ideas of incommensurability, no dialogue is possible. So we have to allow for difference, but in a way that is not essentialist, that you can entertain dialogues among different cultures. Concepts that are used in different cultures, embedded in different cultures, but without essentializing these deep cultural differences. But at the same time, recognizing the differences. A great scholar of this country, who prayed I never get the second name of my religion. Okay. He has written beautifully about the concept of equality, freedom from an Indian perspective. It's not an essentialist version. In fact, the concepts come from the Western tradition. But she brings into this concept the Indian reality. That is to say, to find the concepts in terms that are adequate to Indian reality. In fact, I have to say that I have a very personal experience in this. Because when I came from the United States with my PhD, I arrived in Portugal, and at this problem, Portugal is one of the intermediate, less developed countries in Europe. You know, this the southern ring, which was Greece, Portugal, Spain, and so on. And then there are the very developed Germany and France and Finland and whatever. When I arrived from the United States, I had this problem as a sociologist in Portugal. Is that the theories that I had learned in the United States were not adequate to my society. Because the theories that I had studied were either adequate to the developed society like the United States, or to the underdeveloped world, as they call it, like Brazil. But my country was in the middle. It was intermediate development. Later on, the system, world system theories defined them as semi-peripheral. Intermediate development. The concepts that I brought from my sociological studies didn't fit my society. So we have to invent the concepts to act, to analyze our society with our own lenses. So I think this experience today is important, because what is the danger of not recognizing these cultural differences without essentializing them is that what you do here is derivative. That is to say, well, we do class analysis, but they give better than you in the United States or Europe. What are you going to back? They have done the studies. So the scholars from the Global South are always in the wrong side of history, in this case, of the social sciences. But can a scholar from the United States or from Europe analyze the complexity of the relationship between caste and class? They don't even understand what caste is. And probably a scholar from by bringing different concepts, different analysis, And I'm thinking about a particular scholar, Guduma Dilberi, Diyashek, from the Center for Study and Developing Society, that precisely tries to analyze that there are composite, complex, hybrid forms of discrimination that feed on each other. And if you have this with religion, it's even more complex. How could a scholar from Europe make sense of the work that a young scholar from this country, still a PhD candidate, is doing with us in this project about Dalit Muslims? Can you say caste and religion? How complex the situation is for Muslims that consider themselves, they are Dalits and they are Muslims. So the complexities of this society call for probably new concepts and for creativity. But if you want to have creativity, you cannot depend on the textbooks from the global north. You have to create your own concepts and your own ideas and bring into the conversation other authors. And believe me, in this country, or in Africa, throughout Africa, the ones with all my work and all in the past, marvelous work has been done. But sometimes it's not acknowledged as very important. So the first challenge for us is to give credibility to these realities so that they become known and understood with proper lenses, with other ways of looking at them, other than Eurocentric models. The second challenge is what we call external pluralism of knowledge. That is to say, there is internal pluralism within the social sciences, be it sociology, political science, you can tell. But there is also external. What is external? Is that besides scientific knowledge, there are many other knowledges in society which we don't consider in our universities. Popular knowledge, urban knowledge, peasant knowledge, women's knowledge, indigenous knowledge. Knowledge of the social movements. I'm to be puzzled by the idea that by far the majority of the population of the world go about their lives, running their lives based on knowledge that are outside. They are based on other kinds of knowledge. Why is knowledge never ended our universities? Because we only teach the knowledge of the winners. We never teach the knowledge of the losers. Social groups that are oppressed, humiliated, exploited. And that's why they never come to our universities. So I think that we have to bring into the conversation this knowledge. Not because they are better than the social scientific knowledge, no. I usually say that different knowledges are useful for different purposes. If I want to go to the moon, I need scientific knowledge. If I want to preserve the biodiversity of the Amazonian region, I need indigenous knowledge. Because they are the ones that know the plants, the herbs, the waters, the rivers, the streams. Nobody else. So it depends. Do I want to go to the moon? Well, science, of course. Do I want to preserve biodiversity? Indigenous knowledge. For different purposes, we use different knowledges. And everyone on the streets here that I see in Mumbai, they do that every day. I mean, look at the people. Our people are obsessed with mobile phones. Does it mean that these people that use these technological fixes are all scientists? No. They use the mobile phones to convey and change their own knowledge. So they do combinations of knowledge. They have no problem with using mobile phones because it's technologically useful. But they don't restrict their activities to this. So there is this idea that we need to bring an ecology of knowledge. That's the basis of my epistemological proposal. That is to say, different knowledges, that are useful for different purposes.
In the end, we have to be serious about our purposes.
Knowledge for whom? Knowledge for whose interests? For what purposes? We are believing very often that at the university we teach knowledge for the sake of knowledge. Well, I don't think that's the reality. In fact, the administrations of other universities throughout the world, I hope it's not the case in India, I know very little about university, but I know about other universities. Social science are not useful. So they are chronically underfunded. Because what we need is patterns. What we need is useful knowledge. So they themselves have now an idea of usefulness that is leading to the closing down of entire departments in the United States, in the UK. In some universities where I've been, in London, in Warwick, closing down the departments of humanities, comparative literature, sociology, closing down because there are no funds for that. So what do we gain by bringing in into the conversation all these different knowledges? What we gain are simple things, but they are important. The first one is that the fact that we have focused solely on scientific knowledge, Western-centric scientific knowledge, or even non-Western-centric scientific knowledge. The fact that we have considered this knowledge as the only valid knowledge has destroyed much knowledge in the world. Knowledge of the people that we don't value, discard that knowledge. Discard the knowledge of scavengers, showing studies in informal work. They're beautiful, important knowledge for their lives. We do what I call epistemicide, the destruction of knowledge, the killing of knowledge. So science is very useful if it is one and a very important source of knowledge. But it may be very damaging if it is considered the only valid form of knowledge. Because it is so badly distributed in the world that if this is the only form of valid knowledge, then much destruction can take place. Look at the economic knowledge of the CEOs of the World Bank, of the IMF, how much destruction they have created around the world. How much destruction they are creating today in Europe. My country is under the tutelage of the IMF at this point, the European Union. These people, these consultancy firms, these investment banks, and these multilateral agencies, they seek to have a truth in them, which is neoclassical economics. And all this seems to be a kind of an automatic knowledge. It's always valid. We don't have to prove that it is valid. Because apparently there is no alternative to these kinds of knowledge. So you have, for our concerns, lots of weak answers. If I want to improve the well-being of people in the planet these days, what is the response I get from these institutions? Economic growth. That's the only thing. And if you open the newspapers, they are only concerned about economic growth. But which, you know, which type of economic growth? Is the economic growth that may be reducing poverty, that may be reducing the destruction of the planet, the ecological disaster, or other kinds of economic growth. Usually, we don't get a very good response about that. And in fact, development, which has so many objectives now, sustainable development, human development, integral development, democratic development, all of it points down to economic growth, free markets, poverty reduction, structural adjustment, other things. So I don't think that we have a solution here. So you have to find other alternatives. And for that, I think that probably what we need to understand is that the understanding of the world by far exceeds the Western understanding of the world. There are other ways of understanding the world, other than those that have been dominated for some centuries now. And I think we should start a conversation about this. And if you follow this, you can see the diversity of the world in a much better lens. You can evaluate, you can really give credibility to all this innovation that is taking place in social movements throughout the global south. And this innovation is what I usually say, that we don't need alternatives. Because alternatives are there, but they never come to our departments. We never consider it. What we need is an alternative thinking of alternatives. Because the alternatives are there, but they're not made better. So there is something that another finding from this perspective is that there will be no social justice without cognitive justice. That is to say, without justice among different knowledges. A fourth idea, and the final idea in this, is that we discover all this diversity. But this diversity, I'm going to give you examples. But how do I make sense of this diversity? How do I create communication among different, diverse ways of analyzing society? For many people in India and any other country that were based on the Western-centric conceptions of liberation of emancipation, myself included, of course, I used to think for many, many years that a better society is a socialist society. And socialism has been a very important concept for us. But if I work with social movements in the global south, they tell me that socialism is another colonialist threat. The indigenous peoples in Latin America tell me it is a white man's threat, like capitalism. But they formulate in their own language ideas of a better society. They don't call it socialism, but they call it a better society, a better way of living in harmony with nature. How am I going to make sense of all these experiences? These are very complete problems to which I've been addressing when we are involved with the movements that are trying to transform the rules of society. And I'll give you just a few examples. The first one is the diversity of conceptions of land. For us, land is land. Simple as that. Well, it is not so. Different social groups in our societies have a different conception of land that leads to different social objectives and social struggles. For some, land is just the ground upon which they can produce, the soil on which they can produce their own products. Many of them are landless peasants, and they struggle for a great land reform. Land for them is soil. For the indigenous people, land is territory, is sacred territories, is self-determination. I've been working for a long time with indigenous movements in Latin America. There are conflicts among peasants, between peasants and indigenous peoples. And why? Because they have a different conceptions of land. For peasants, land is land, it's the soil. For indigenous people, it's their identity. Because they cannot think of their identity without territory, without self-determination, internal self-determination, as it is called. So it's a different kind of concept of land. And I can take a third element, which are in Latin America, for instance, the Afro-descendants, the Africans that came as slaves to Latin America. they also have a different concept of land. It's the land that they occupied when they were runaway slaves. When they ran away from the slavery and went into the bushes and created their own plots of land. Their land is not agrarian reform. Their land is not territory. They have even a different concept, which in Portuguese or Brazil is quilombo, in Spanish is palenque. Different words to express that. So we have to understand this diversity of conceptions of land. And I give you a second example, the concept of human rights. Many of us think that human rights are universal, even though they were originated in the Western world. Is anybody in the world ready to accept that human rights are universal? Well, it is easy to answer yes if you have not been victim of human rights in your country. If I talk to Egyptians about human rights, they will never forget that when Napoleon invaded in 1809 Egypt, the justification for the invasion of Egypt was, I'm bringing you human rights. So, human rights were coming together with the invasion of their lands. So they cannot think the same way as someone in Europe that had thought of human rights as a liberating thing. So you have, when we were organizing the World Social Forum in Tunisia, the idea was that the topic of this World Social Forum would be human rights. But North African social movements refused to accept the idea. Because I said, this is imperialism. We have been victimized under the name of human rights for foundation in the past in very nasty things in India, legitimate by the concept of human rights. And I'm not going into the text, particularly women, not that, sisters. So we have invented a different name for people to be consensually agreeing on a concept that would be a learning process for everyone. And that concept was dignity. Not human rights, but human dignity. Because human dignity is a key concept in many countries, and a key concept in Islam, is a key concept in indigenous people's cosmovisions, concept of dignity and concept of respect. They are not concepts. They are different from human rights. It's different. How different? Yeah, probably I can't tell, but people that are in conversation, we can see the difference. So, these are examples of the diversity of the world when we look at it in these South-South dialogues. Because, for instance, we have today a movement of peasants toward the global south. It's called Via Campesina. And Via Campesina is the federation of peasants' unions in more than 100 countries now. They have different conceptions of land. They have different concepts of food. And now they have agreed on a given concept, which is probably problematic. Particularly for economists, it's very problematic. But it's the concept they have agreed upon. It's the concept of food sovereignty. Food sovereignty is a concept that is opposed to the concept of food security. And they have been promoting this concept against, obviously, particularly multinational corporations that think that through transgenic food, they will solve of the food for people. While people are feeling these three kinds of vulnerability more and more. Food, vulnerability, ecological vulnerability, and financial vulnerability. So, My invitation to you is to see how we can, in fact, start a conversation on different concepts. Of course, we know that immediately comes the idea of cultural relativism or cultures are the same, and if you bring in traditional knowledge, you bring communalism and so on. You know all that by probably, and it's a serious debate. We cannot, of course, discard, diminish this debate. But we have to address this debate. We have to understand the debate and try to bring in creative knowledges about these forms of intercultural translation. I work a lot with also indigenous movements and women's movements, for instance. And I have come across all the, I mean, all the reproaches and prejudices between women's movements and indigenous or peasants' movements. And we have been able to try to start a conversation about different concepts of gender equality. There is not a single concept of gender equality. There are different concepts of gender equality. The indigenous people in Latin America speak of Shashawangi, which is a casual word, that would approximately mean reciprocity, complementarity, but it's not equality, something different. There is an interesting debate between the World March of Women now, which is a very large social movement around the world, between women that have a kind of a Western-centric concept of equality or a peasant or indigenous or non-Western concept of liberation and gender non-discrimination. So, and you may say, what is the word? Why do we need this? Well, you don't need that if you are sitting there and doing your art and become a corporate lawyer or whatever. You don't. We need that whenever you bring outsiders to the surface of those that are oppressed in our societies. If you want, in fact, to be social scientists with a social responsibility, that our science should be socially responsible, that we should, the privilege that we have of being in universities is to be at the service of those that can never have access to the university, to their struggles. Then we start to understand that we have to have an open eye to these other realities and not just come to them and tell them that we have solutions. Because if you have the solutions, we are going to see that they are the problem all the time, and we are not the problem. Take my final example. Take the example of the schools of aeronautics, of agronomy, in Toronto, what do I don't know any Indians, as I said, I'm not speaking about it. Most grants for the students in agronomy, engineering, today the grants come from the bean seeds company. Seeds company. Carrier, Novartis, Monsanto. These companies pay all these grants to the students with a simple obligation. Every year they have to visit the plants of Monsanto and Carrier. Why is that? Because when they leave school, they go through rural extension, which is a word very well known, and they are going to teach agro-industrial monoculture. Transgenic seeds, they are not going to be sensitive to agroecology. They are not going to be sensitive to peasants' agriculture, to indigenous subsistence economies. So they are trained in such a way that agro-industry is the solution. Even though we know that 85% of the food that we eat everywhere in the world is produced by peasants. It's not produced by them. But we think that solution for what they are doing. So, if we really pause a little bit and think about our social responsibility. And when I talk about land, I could talk about labor, labor unions, trade unions, the informal sector, as Shib and Shari in this team is working. How can we, in fact, address the realities, helping them, but helping them in a such a term, in such a way, that they became really powerful? Self-esteem, because nobody changes the world if it has no self-esteem, individually and collectively. If my culture is not respected, I'm not going to respect other cultures. I respect my culture, and I will respect other cultures, if my culture is respected. And I take care of the environment if I don't have to be so concerned about feeding my family tomorrow. Because if I have to feed my family tomorrow and I don't know how I'm going to feed my family, should I be concerned about the environment, climate change? So in order to be more sensitive to the different realities that we face today in the world, my idea is that never discard social sciences. I'm a social scientist, so I'm not discarding my own job. What I'm saying that in order to be good social scientists, we have to understand that there are other knowledges in society, and that our knowledge should be at the service of facilitating a conversation with other knowledges, that is to say with other people, with other groups. Most of them have no access to our universities. Because if you don't pay attention to this, we have to, and this is against this blasphemy, probably said here. Since they invited me, I'm here, I use my position while I'm talking. Then in the debate with them, of course, question and that's it. Is that one of the interesting things about the modern university, particularly the university from the 19th century on, is that we allow for the development of revolutionary ideas in reactionary institutions. There are revolutionary ideas, provided they are accepted in the university society. Provided we are in an ivory tower. An ivory tower. So, I think it is time for us to open our eyes and see that probably we should be better equipped to be more democratic in terms of knowledge. So my proposal to you here, with all risks that you can imagine, is that if you want to democratize society, we have to democratize knowledge. It doesn't mean to accept all kinds of knowledge, no. We have to criticize all knowledge, traditional knowledge, peasant knowledge, but also scientific knowledge. And not look at those as a problem and as a solution. Because we have committed lots of mistakes. We have conducted wars and wars. We have destroyed cities with atom bombs in the name of science. It's time that we pause. And we think that scientific knowledge is very precious, absolutely. But once we recognize that it has to be involved in a very wider conversation, then be a bit more humble, accepting that there are other knowledges, and sometimes we are wrong in our premises, and we should not be the vanguard of the world, because we are not going to be for that. So that would be my talks, and of course I will be ready for comments or for questions, of course, if you have something. Thank you.
Any questions, sir? Questions, comments? That was okay. Is someone?
Please? My problem is that I may not hear you.
Okay.
Or if you come here, you can borrow my bike. Let's speak from here, because otherwise I don't care. Come here, speak from here.
Since the Great Depression, fundamental concepts came under a scanner in a way that even mainstream northern politicians, economists could not avoid discussion. In spite of such a long standing crisis, Portugal being one of the ones affected very strongly, there has not been, unlike the 60s or other eras, a coherent, global, or even a Western response, either in the politics or in the economics, that has been able to present a challenge. So to the effect that now we have this very wounded model of liberal capitalism, of the financialized capitalism, still the only game in town. It is wounded, it's staggering, but it remains there and it is not understood in a way that I can see ideologically. Where, what are the roots of this failure? Would you locate them in some of the lack of ideas that we still need to develop? Or would you locate them in a different space? So I'd be interested in trying to understand that. And I just have one more question related to also to liberal capitalism. There is, you posited very interestingly a difference between a liberal capitalism that is also a US citizen that has a solution, the same solution for every place and every time maybe. And the response to that is the diversities, the 100,000 different ways of thinking, being, knowing. Structurally, how does one universal way of thinking, in an age where we have a telecommunications revolution and the world is, how can it be countered by such a vast diversity of small challenges? Is there a structural mismatch here that we need to address in order to counter the hegemonic thing?
I don't take three questions. developing.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you for that talk. Two questions. One is, there have been critiques of universalism in where you work in Kanti, local, north, south, everywhere. The responses to universalism sometimes have been that of let a thousand flowers bloom, you know, let's have multiple knowledges, multiple languages, different kinds of perspectives, if you will. But one suspicion remains, especially when we're just simply trying to replace the universal or the question of validity with the question of multiplicity. I mean, with the response of let there be multiple perspectives. Because sometimes one feels that one is losing out on that question of validity altogether. And then and it also seems like a form of appropriation there. You know, okay, we will have science, for instance, to go to the moon. And we will, you know, approach the indigenous knowledges, and that itself is a diverse and hugely conflicted space. But we will approach the indigenous, as it were, for all the other things, as it were. And my question is, does this actually help crack the hegemony of conquest inside technology itself? That's one. The other thing is, we also have this. We try to access knowledges other than the hegemonic ones, if you will, to refer to other practices, for instance. So the many names, I mean, we try to, in trying to study cultures other than our own, we try to access even terms for practices, the names people may have for their own practices, and so on and so forth. And we are trying to therefore also get at what might be different practices from the universal, from the hegemonic. But the translation continues to be on the terms of you know, what we know. And while that is perhaps how it is, I mean, one cannot translate except in terms of what we know, but a non-recognition that we are doing that also tends to retain the hegemony. So we are still translating dignity as something, we are translating respect as something. Anthropologists keep doing this.
Education system. And so what we have seen is that
central to marginalization of communities has been marginalization of their knowledge. So unless and until we start talking at that level, I think sociology will really fail to, we will not be able to have any conversation with these communities or the forms of knowledge, the language, concepts, worldviews. Because I think at one level it is the kind of conversation between worldviews. And thirdly, it's not a question of using science for space visit to moon and using some other knowledge for preservation of biodiversity in the Amazon and so on. What do we do with plural knowledges or different knowledges that address the same issue? Okay. So that is where the whole hegemony being reproduced, between powerful groups among the so-called indigenous groups or natives or non-Western groups.
Can you respond to this one?
You have the mic. You have a mic.
I have a mic here. Oh, thank you. Very interesting questions. I think the first question I have some difficulties in getting about the balance that you were looking for. And I think that was the balance among different kinds of knowledges for the different types of purposes that we have in society. But I think that my quest is precisely that in the end, our conversation is about politics, that is to say, what is a balance? What is the equilibrium that we find in different ways of living in our societies? And there are opposing views about this. And there are probably areas in which probably no balance is possible. For instance, I didn't mention, but one of the topics in which I have been most involved in recent times is concepts of nation. Because in the Western-centric model, nature is natural resources. And the nature, of course, does not belong to society. Society is one thing, nature is a different. But we have cultures, in fact, traditional Asian cultures, Hinduism included, in which nature is included in a kind of a cosmic entity. Indigenous peoples, for instance, in several continents, consider nature as Mother Earth, as Mother. Nature is an entity, a living entity. And many years ago, when I was doing research in Colombia, I would never understand in the beginning that when the oil drilling companies were trying to drill oil in the sacred territories of the indigenous land, the indigenous people called the oil blood. And I didn't understand in the beginning. It's for them, there is a unity between our blood and nature. So, oil is the blood of nature that is connected to our own blood. And so if these companies go ahead with the mining these sacred territories, they will take away their own blood. So it's a different conception of nature. Between these two concepts of nature, it is difficult to strike a balance, they are different conceptions. And we have to let the conference today, in fact, based on this, for it's a sub-ecological movement today, come close to the indigenous concept of nature. We had a huge meeting in Tiquipaya, which is a small city in Bolivia, in which ecologists and indigenous and peasants from all over the place came, more than 100,000 people, to discuss the Mother Earth. That is to say, nature. And we could see that it is possible to create alliances based on very different conceptions of nature. So, I come from a culture in which God is some kind of a personal entity, right? Judeo-Christian God is different from gods here, is different from the indigenous spirituality for whom gods are rivers, rivers are sacred, mountains are sacred, trees are sacred. They have a different conception of divinity, of religion, and therefore of nature. How can we combine this? But it is easy to discard them as kind of residues or kind of superstition. These indigenous people today, in many parts of the world, and I would suspect even in India, they are just considered obstacles to development. Here they get these crazy people with the idea that nature is Mother Earth. Nature is nature. So they are obstacles. They are retrograde people. They are residues of the past. Neoliberalism, global neoliberalism like this. They lie that these people are considered obstacles to development. But we should think otherwise. The second question, I think it's a very good question also. It's what are the roots of failure that after the crisis in 2008, for a while everybody thought that this was the moment to discredit neoclassic economics once and for all. They have failed. And apparently the guys that created the crisis are the guys that are solving it. That is to say, they were so powerful that they generated the crisis and they solved it in such a way they even make money with the crisis. So we are bailing out banks, but we are not bailing out families. There is no welfare. Our welfare states in many countries are banking welfare states. There is welfare states for financial capital, not for the families, and much less for the poor. Why is that? Why is that? Well, it's a political issue again. I think that one has to do with the crisis of communism and socialism. The fall of the Berlin Wall was a tectonic movement. Because everything, now we know that much of what the 20th century had produced until 1989 was the product of the Cold War. The fact that there was an alternative on the other side. When this alternative collapses, then there is no alternative within capitalism. Because the idea was, and we forgot, people on the left, critical social theorists, forgot that, that alternatives to capitalism was the condition for alternatives within capitalism. That's why European capitalism was very different from US capitalism. And these two were very different from Japanese capitalism. We used to call United States liberal capitalism, Europe social democratic capitalism, Japan corporatist and South Korea corporatist capitalism, France state capitalism, German mixed economy social market capitalism, Fordism and peripheral Fordism. Look at the names. So they were alternatives. The Berlin Wall falls, and there is just one form of capitalism. Libra, US-based capitalism, what we call the neoliberalism. So we lost these alternatives all of a sudden. And at this point, we don't have enough therapy. And that's why, and I work and analyze the sociologists, these revolts that are taking place, all the Occupy movement in the US, the Indignados movement in Southern Europe, the student movement in Chile or in Brazil. They know very well what they don't want, but they don't know what they want. That's our time. We know what we reject: concentration of wealth, corruption, the destruction of democracy because it has been captured by anti-democratic forces, by powerful economic interests all over the world. Lobbyists in the United States are the legalized corruption. They buy and sell votes every day. We consider this repugnant. We are enraged against this. But what is our alternative? It is a time in which we don't find. There is no alternative with a capital A. So what we find is that social movements, peasants' movements, we are going to organize here with Chad itself a popular session of what we call the Popular University of the Social Movements. We are bringing together here in Mumbai movements, peasants' movements from all over India that are fighting against land grabbing and displacement by mining companies or mega projects, right? Well, they know that they don't want that. But is there a solution in terms of a socialist or a collective property or something as we used to have in the past? So I think it's an epochal time, which I usually say, this time is too late to be post-revolutionary and too premature to be pre-revolutionary. So I don't know where we are. The third question on diversity and the reversal. Well, it's interesting. It's a good question also, but the problem is that we think that globalization could homogenize the world, and in many respects it does. For instance, globalization of entertainment is Americanization basically today. And even, you know, some Global South experiments, they have to feed into a kind. You know, it's not by chance that we speak about volume. It's because they enter a kind of a hegemonic framework. The problem is that globalization does not homogenize. Globalization fragments more and more. And why is that? Because labor is now a global resource. But there is no global labor market. So there are people, and this comes to a discussion later on, that even the hegemonic concepts are so constructed that people cannot fit into those concepts. For instance, today many people do lots of things that they don't consider that they are workers, because the concept of labor, and the concept of work does not cover their activities. Women have known that for a long time. That's why today we talk about the economy of caring, which in many countries is dominated by women. Or informal economy in Africa is dominated by women. So I think that we live in a world in which on one side we have these global markets which we think they are very anonymous. The invisible hand, you see the markets, say this, not the markets. We know that there are six or seven institutional investors that decide every day the political risks in India or the political risks in Portugal. But they are unknown. We don't know them. But we know they are the large institutional investors. So it's not really automatic, invisible. There are concrete people that make these decisions. I usually call it a new impersonal dictatorship. We have the constitutions of the countries, like the constitution of India, progressive constitution. But above this constitution, there is a global constitution, of neoliberalism, which collides with national constitutions. I think that we have to live with the realities of this fragmentation. How can we link together social movements or organizations together? It's a very difficult task. I usually say that I'm a tragic optimist, but you know, there are not many reasons to be optimistic these days. For instance, last year we brought together peasants from Brazil with peasants from Mozambique that are fighting against the same mining company. The same Brazilian mining company displaced peasants in Brazil and displaced peasants in Africa. They didn't know that. They were victims of the same company. So could they articulate their struggle and resist more effectively against my company? That's what that was our purpose. So I think that we have to go start from this fragmentation and try to diminish it. Because there is no unified view of a better society. Communism may be for some, but not for all. Socialism may be for some, but not for all. And we have to live with this reality our time. Maybe in 10 years or 20 years, there will be a unified alternative. We are still living under the damage of the fall of the Berlin Wall. And I'm not saying, I never defended the regimes on the other side. But they played a very important role. They tamed capitalism. They kept capitalism with fear. Capitalism now has no fear. Look at what they are doing in Europe. The continent of social markets, of labor rights, of public health, of public education, of social security. They are privatizing everything. They are destroying labor rights every day, cutting pensions, cutting salaries. And something that is present in our belief was saying, that for neoclassical evidence, which is not proven, but that's absolutely taken as a dogma, is that social expenditures, that is to say, expenditures in health, in education, is an expenditure, it's not an investment. We use a time in which this would be an investment. We invest in the new generation of scholars, of technicians, and so on. Now it is not considered an investment, it's a cost. And it is a cost, it has to be reduced. So, is this empirical evidence? No. It's neoliberalism in its strength and in fact without fear of a systemic global crisis. May occur, but nobody knows. Could be another war. The Europeans should know. Europe is the only continent that in the same century, they had two bloody wars. Do you know how many people were killed in Europe in the two wars? Over 60 million. No other continent killed so many people in the same century. Do we have a third war? Another war? We don't know. I think that the question on the questions of validity of knowledge is a very serious question. I think that we should not aim at universal ideas of validity. I mean, we today even in studies of science, we talk about strong objectivity. You see, the idea is that the criteria of validation has to be situated. They should be situated. They cannot be seen in abstract. That's why one size does not fit all. So we should be very sensitive to contexts. And that's why my epistemological proposal is to be more sensitive to global, to contexts in which we work. They may not be valid for everyone, but they are valid for those people there. So, I don't have a very clear answer to that validation has to come from bottom. So, I usually talk about subaltern universities. universalism that comes from bottom, not in an abstraction. For instance, I don't believe that we have humanity. Humanity does not exist, in my view. It's an aspiration. Because so many people are considered subhuman that I don't think that it is a reality. I think that translation is still an hegemonic, maybe an hegemonic class. But giving this statement as linguistic translation. If we take linguistic translation, of course, translation is an empirical project. Who translates whom? There are the target languages, their target literary novels or whatever, and there is someone that is translating them. The translations I'm talking about are simple. I come from the experience of having on the same table, in a round table, people with different ideas. And we have to start a conversation. And to start a conversation, I have to understand why you don't like the concept of liberation, or you don't like the concept of socialism, but you like the concept of a better life. What is this? So translation is this, it's cultural translation, in which we know there are inequalities. But we do our work so that the inequalities are diminished by the translation. But this is a very humble, very messy type of project. This is not linguistic translation, of course. But we know that language is very important. For instance, if I use even more blasphemies, I would think it's impossible to create a critical social science in English when only 20% of the population speaks English. How not? What do they think of people that don't master the language? Or other science? Well, when we say that, you say deciding when this destruction of knowledge or feeling of knowledge, I think the problem is precisely that many people, in many instances, they don't have the language even to express their aspirations. One of the things that colonialism did, in my view, was to destroy the ways in which people could pronounce a future different from the colonial future that was presented to them. So today, sometimes, they don't even have the language. We have indigenous movements throughout the world that are reinventing their language because they lost it. Here in this country, we have thousands of different languages. This is the diversity, and I think it is good if we manage to have the conversation. In this workshop here, we are going to have some people here in our meeting that don't speak English. So the problem for me is not what they are missing, it's not what I'm missing. The other day, I had a very long conversation with a great scholar, a woman in this country, a great economist. And she was asking, I'm not going to mention the name, she was telling me, you know, these people, sometimes they have so many problems. We're talking about the Sheldon Carter and so on, that they don't even know how to distinguish blue from green, red from orange. There are people that have very difficulties. Lots of difficulties in distinguishing things that for us are evident. And my question to her was this, but what are they capable of distinguishing that we are not capable? What do they know that we don't know? We only assign the limits of their knowledge. What about our knowledge limits when seen from their perspective? It's because we are in an imperial position, a position of power. So I think that we have to take that into account. And finally, to go to the last points. Yes, it is so that when I talk about university, I should be talking about education systems. Yeah, that's true, and this would be another seminar. And you raise a very interesting point, and to that I would need to think more about it, because this particular series, from my point of view, because of my own reflection on this. Is it? In fact, I have developed my work on different knowledges for different purposes. What about this different knowledge to address the same issue? Or the same purpose? But is it the same purpose? Is it the same issue when it is addressed by different knowledge. You know, if I address the issue of family from this knowledge or that knowledge, is family the same issue? Or each knowledge can see some of the family in different ways? So the idea of the same issue and different issues are tricky one. Because the issue is defined by the very knowledge that is enters the conversation. So, but I don't have this very well worked out. And I think that I should think a bit more. So thank you very much for the conversation.